The Lord allows you, no, the devil allows you, God is his one, because we don't have any music. That's all right, but we can use our voice to sing praise to his name, amen. I will sound up that every praise belongs to our God. We can use it now because every praise still belongs to our God, amen. Every praise.
Love me.
But we have come into this house, gathered in his name to worship Christ the Lord.
Amen.
Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. That's all right. Amen.
We have come into this house, gathered in his name to worship him.
We have come.
We have come into this house, gathered in his name to worship him.
God to be inside this house once again this morning. And we give honor and praise for who he is and what he continues to do in our lives. Amen. Amen. Hallelujah. At this time, I tell you, remain on your feet. We're going to look to the Lord and pray this morning. Hallelujah. Most precious and heavenly Father, we come before you in front of grace this morning, O God. As humbly as we know how, O God, with an open heart and an open mind, O God, to receive something from you on this morning. For you are a God and creator of all things. Heaven and earth rejoice at the sound of your name, O God.
Hallelujah.
Lord God, we thank you for allowing us to have a place of worship, O God. To be able to magnify your name, to be able to call upon your name in our times of need, oh God. Even when we just want to give you thanks, oh God. You place us in an area where we can do that, oh God. Without having to look to the left, to the right, to figure out who is judging us. But we can just focus just on you and you alone, oh God. So, Lord God, we thank you on this morning for opening up these doors, oh God. Lord God, we ask you to take full control of this service, oh God. Whatever you have us to do, whatever you have us to say, oh God, let it be done to magnify your name, oh God. For you alone are worthy to be praised and to be exalted. Oh God, we thank you for our bishop and our pastor and their absence, oh God. We ask you to give them safe travel, grace, and mercy, and those that are traveling with them, oh God. Oh God, we thank you for our guest speaker and those other guests that are here as well, oh God. Lord God, we come to receive a word from you this morning, oh God. So God, whatever you have for us, oh God, let us be able just to receive it and be able just to share it with somebody that doesn't know you, oh God. For we are the light into this world, God, so we can shine the light into the darkest areas, that we can pull someone out so they can be able to feel the warmth of your embrace, oh God. So we thank you, we magnify your name, oh God. Lord God, we ask you to go up and down the invisible aisle, oh God. There's somebody that's here that needs a touch from you, oh God. So we ask you to just meet them right where they are, oh God. Mend the brokenhearted, heal the sick and the afflicted, oh God. Lord God, bless those that are on the way, give them safe travel, grace, and mercy. And those that aren't able to be here with us this morning, oh God. For we give your name the praise, the glory, and the honor, for it belongs to you and you alone. In Jesus' mighty name we pray. Amen. Praise God. At this time, I'm going to ask Brother Frost Cooper to come with a scripture for us this morning.
Amen.
Amen.
Please turn to me from the book of Psalm 100. This is a sound of praise. Joyful noise unto the Lord, all ye lands. Serve the Lord with gladness. Come before his presence with singing. Know ye that the Lord, he is God. It is he that hath made us and not we ourselves. We are his people and sheep of his pasture. Enter into his gate with thanksgiving and into his court with praise. Be thankful unto him and bless his name. For the Lord is good. His mercy is everlasting and is true and endureth to all generations. May the Lord bless his reign and be sanctified to our heart in Jesus' name.
Amen. Amen.
Praise the Lord, somebody. Praise the Lord, everybody. Hallelujah. God is good. And all the time. Hallelujah. Brother Franz just read that we have to enter to his gates with thanksgiving into our hearts. And we have to enter to his courts with praise. Amen?
Amen.
Hallelujah. So at this time, I'm going to be reading the Rehoboth Lighthouse, Full Gospel Church, Doctrine of Faith. It says, we believe the Bible to be the inspired, the only infallible, authoritative word of God, and inerrant in the original writings. We believe that there is one God, eternally existing in three persons, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. We believe in the deity of our Lord Jesus Christ, in his virgin birth, in his sinless life, in his miracles, in his vicarious and atoning death through his shed blood, in his bodily resurrection, in his ascension to the right hand of the Father, and his personal return in power and glory. We believe that the lost and sinful man must be saved, and that man's only hope of redemption is through the shed blood of Jesus Christ, the Son of God. We believe in and practice the holy ordinance of water baptism, which signifies the believer's death, burial, and resurrection into new life with Christ Jesus, and regular celebration of Holy Communion as commanded by our Lord. We believe in the present ministry of what we need. We believe in the present ministry and baptism of the Holy Spirit, by whose indwelling the Christian is enabled to live a godly life. We believe in the resurrection of both the saved and unsaved, those that are saved into the resurrection of life, and those that are unsaved into the resurrection of damnation. We believe in the spiritual unity of believers in our Lord Jesus Christ, and this is what we believe in. Amen. Praise God. This time, I'm going to call Elder Debbie Cunningham for this morning's welcome and announcement.
Praise the Lord, everybody.
Praise the Lord.
Come on, praise the Lord, everybody.
Praise the Lord.
Are you glad to be here today?
Yes.
Let me hear you shout Jesus.
Jesus.
Come on, let me hear you shout Jesus.
Jesus.
Praise the Lord, the name that is above every other name. Amen.
Yes.
Praise the Lord, the sound of the name of Jesus, the enemy will flee. And we are thankful to be in God's house this morning. Welcome one and all on behalf of the Bishop Francis of the House and our co-pastor. Carl and have left this opportunity to welcome you all to Rehoboth Lighthouse Gospel Church, 409 Washington Street, Haverhill, Massachusetts. There's anyone here for the very first time. I know we have our visiting team, and we give you a special welcome.
Amen.
We're thankful that we took the time out to be with the ladies of yesterday and to be with us on today. We are grateful to have you here this morning. But welcome. There's always a warm Christian welcome in God's house. Amen. Our bishop always reminds us that God's people are the greatest people on earth.
Amen.
And it should indeed be a privilege to be a part of the family
Amen.
Of God. Amen. Praise the Lord. Make sure you feel welcome here this morning. Bishop always told us the first time you come, you're a visitor. Next time, you're no more visitor, but you're a part of God's family.
Amen.
Praise the Lord. We welcome you all. Our other services are Sunday mornings at 9 a.m. We have adults from the school. Downstairs at 10 a.m. we have our morning worship service right here in the sanctuary. This and every Sunday afternoon we gather back at 6 p.m. for our power, where we come and we share our testimonies. Mondays at 10 a.m. the women's gathering prayer. And at 6:30 p.m. we have Wounds to God, a program for men only. And at 7 p.m. we have our regular church intercessory prayer. Tuesday between 2 to 4 p.m. we have outreach ministry where we serve coffee and pastry to those who come and we try to meet their spiritual needs. And at 7 p.m. we have a women's gathering. Thursday at 7 p.m. regular church Bible study immediately following our choir rehearsal. Fridays teen Bible study, the ages are from 13 years and up. Saturdays smaller children meet, the youth group, the ages are from 3 to 12, and the time is 11 to 3 p.m. And at 7 p.m. we have our men's choir. These are all the events of the week. Please try to attend them to our possible. May God come to bless each and every one of you. Just have one quick announcement as a reminder that our sister Julie's brother has passed away. And we will be having their memorial service on Saturday at 2 o'clock. Right here at Rehoboth. All are welcome to come and support our sister Julie. Alright, that's a memorial service for the brother. Also, by way of reminder, night out with the Lord on May 28, 2016 at 2 p.m.
Amen.
then if you would like to be a part or you want to participate, excuse me, participate, please see your sister Lorinda Jones. Night out with the Lord, May 28th at 2 p.m. Also, if you would like to be a part of the
Salud.
Group song, there will be a practice of the service. Please see where it ends up about that. Amen? Praise the Lord. At this time, I would like to call the Rehoboth Lighthouse Sanctuary Choir. Come on, put your hands together for the choir.
Praise the Lord. Amen. God is able to do just what he says he will do. He's going to fulfill every promise to you. So don't give up on God, for he won't give up on you. He's able.
Bye.
for the choir this morning, amen. Hallelujah. Come on, let's not praise the Lord. Hallelujah. This is the part of the service that everybody can partake in. Great number receive this morning's offering at this time, amen. So I say, you just prepare your heart to take up this morning's offering. I will call them the ushers to take up this morning's offering at this time, amen.
Praise the Lord, if you're in need of a tithing envelope, please raise your hand and one will be provided for you. It is third Sunday. Be with us for the weekend, amen. 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 I don't know about you, but we were all four yesterday, and I'm expecting some more today, amen. Praise the Lord. Stay to your feet, please. A gentle reminder yourself of the mom, and I ask that you please turn it to quiet or silent. Amen. Dear precious and heavenly Father, Lord, we thank you for another opportunity to come before your throne of grace and mercy, Father. Thank you for the day that you have given us. Father, we ask that you bless us offer 200-fold for building up and edifying of your kingdom and your people. We will be careful to give you praise, glory, and honor because it all belongs to you. In Jesus' name I pray. Those on my left, please be seated. Those in the middle and on the right, remain standing. And to the units, we do from the back to the front.
Thank you.
until.
Yeah, I thought he was on Sunday. He was
in God. Amen. I said,
I thought he was on the first one.
Sweet hour of prayer. Sweet hour of prayer.
I'm 85 years old, but I feel like I'm, sometimes I feel like I'm 60.
All right.
Morning. I have light they are young kids. Everybody get a good husband. They dare not stand up and talk to a husband and I don't look in their face. I have to look at him and say, I said, what are you doing? My girl, you don't feel his face. So get away. You don't feel that face. How scary that lady here, she know me good too. First one. Second one, I was in Jamaica. She called me. She said, Mama, I don't like to go back to Jamaica so quick, you know. I said, my mother is there. I can't leave her out. That's my mother. And I want to sing the song and tell you what my mother sings for me when I come home. All right? I hear about that little guy. One night I hear the nothing at the door. At the door, at my birth. Like I say, somebody at the door. I say, is the man answer the door? I'm inside. I said, what you want? I said, no, you get off then. You not see Mary. You not see my baby girl. Ain't Mary. Go. Second, the third one now. Come. And I see that guy. He was in college in Boston. And he break his leg. And she said she wants to go. And she went by the car to go. I said, wait a minute. I said, I want to go here. So I fell out. I'm going to go here. And I'm going to go here. I said, I'm going to go here. And I said, stop. I said, wait a minute. She's in green. So where's that from? I'm not from here. I said, you love this girl? He said, yes, Mama. Everybody call me Mama. I am Mama to everybody. I don't know how many children I have, but I am Mama. I don't know how much I have with some mama. Yes, in the market, mama. That's one answer. Some parents in the room. Is you all speaking? I said, I don't mama in here. He said, this is one I want. I said, okay. Hey, let me know. We are good friends. The boys are so good. Oh my God. Carry to heaven. Jesus. The boys, they were like, I pick from the girls. They have. It's not me pick them. They bring them to mama. It's not me pick. I don't go to the door and pick them up and bring them. They bring them, come and show them to mama. When they find a house, they have to call me. I say, Mama, come look now. You understand there. You come and look up. I say, I think you're going to want. I say, no, this one, you're not even here. You're crazy. I don't know who got me. I say, you're crazy. You're not even up here. Come on. You move again. And I'm telling you something. I'm picking up a lot of time. I'm telling you something. When I come from Jamaica, I was like, I'm about to put all about it. In front of me. $5 one time. Come out of here. You know what I mean? Four is 4 days. The last 4 is 2 days. I turn as a Jesus will be moving with me. It is, I work, you know. I'm not lazy. Sometimes when I'm in the bed, I say, oh God, help me home. I can't lie down in this bed. I have to make hope. I said, what has this been going on here? I said, dear, before church, I'm home. You know, I said, do you want me to work? I said, no, I can't stay in the bed. Do everything. They can't see. They put me home. Come on, mama, you're going to food store. We can't buy fire. Anytime they're ready, and from 6 weeks I go, I like to think 6 weeks is on the other person. Because imagine that I go home to the king. Sometimes I give away, I got them. Somebody wants something, and it's something to eat. And I'm telling you, I'm living in that house now. And the kids in the house. When mama blessed us, I am going here. When I was in Jamaica, and the last girl get a house, she was crying and said, mama, come home. Come home, mama. I'm afraid of the house. I said, why? I said, call Pastor Hobbs. And I called one girl. It's a hard time, yes. That time is the first one I know. I said, call the kindness after that. I said, Pastor Hobbs. And I come back before the time, and I drop here. And I wrote to Pastor, my Pastor, and bless that house. And she's living in that house now. I walk about with another one. And when I walk about, I see a house meeting. These are the women. They go, young boy, and say, hi, guys. What's going on? Yeah. He said, it's all. He said, you want me to marry? I said, yes. He said, you want me to marry? I said, why not? He called me back. She was in the car. I said, come on, come. This house belongs to you. Call your husband. She didn't marry, no. Call your husband. Pastor has married all of them. Five of them, ma'am. Three girls, other girls, and boy. Pastor has the one married them. Marry my kids. Marry them. I said to myself, I wish you could marry me too. Amen. You should have married me too. But I take to the church. Miss the man, they will come when they're ready. I said, I don't expect them, no, 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 to come to church. But every day I ask everybody to pray. I said, pray for the children. Pray for the children. Pastor Francis the house. They are blessed from head to foot. Those two people, I can say this thing with the support. And my children, they're happy. The first one that died in the house is a brand new house village. My very happy is
everybody in this church.
I think everybody loves me too.
Amen.
Nobody don't hate me. I think everybody loves me too. The men they love me. The man, Pastor, Brother MacLeod, he is a good man. You is a good man. Everybody loves me.
Amen.
And
amen.
My sister, I'm telling you this. What's a heaven? Whenever time.
Come to me, Now it's time we'll have the purpose moment.
We just thank God for yesterday. We're truly blessed. Yes. God, we're awesome to come back again today. Ethan, from a woman of God. Yes. God is truly wonderful. We thank God for the family. We thank you for God. God is wonderful. We're awesome by the sweet hour of prayer. And I just want to say one thing before I read her bio. And yesterday, I mean, everything was just awesome. Awesome weekend. But one thing that Sister said over here about all the little gifts. And she goes, everybody can get a gift. She goes, and one, some of you may get a gift. And she goes, you might even re-gift it. And when I thought about that, I was like, you know something? We heard awesome word yesterday. When I got to the last time, I told myself, I said, I knew it was so good. The word was rich. And it's like, I'm going to take that word. I may not have won a gift basket, but I got the word in my belly on yesterday. And I'm going to give that word.
Praise God. Praise God. Praise God.
Jesus. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Father. God.
Everybody not happy for you. You know, when you get blessed, everybody
but I just thank God that what she told me was true. And I miss her, but I know she's gone home with the Lord now. I know she's with the Lord, and so that gives me comfort. And I was just thinking, this past Mother's Day, I was home. A lot of times I'm not at home during that time because, you know, it was kind of depressing for me. But I was home, and I thank God for healing. I thank God, you know, I haven't forgotten my mother, but I thank God for healing. I was not feeling sad and blue and lonely. I thank God for healing. Because he healed me. And maybe that's not a big thing, but when God heals you, when he delivers you, when he takes you out of that lonesome, dry, pitiful place, it's a blessing. And, you know, and I just thank God, when she told me I was going to be blessed, and I'm not bragging, I'm not trying to brag, but I'm blessed. I'm a single mom, you know, my son went through college, and my other son, he had gotten in some trouble, he was in jail, and I know the last time that he was in jail, and before they sentenced him, my youngest son and I, we went to the courthouse. And now we didn't go inside, but I said, Deshaun, come on. We going and we getting ready to walk around this courthouse and pray 7 times. I don't know, somebody needs to hear this testimony, but I'm going to tell it to you. I said, we getting ready to go around here and we getting ready to walk around this courthouse. I said, now God, you are an awesome God. And that's my job. And I birthed him. You gave him to me. And Satan, the blood of Jesus is against you. They said he was gone. He was up for 15 years. I said, the devil is a liar. And so I did. We shared exchange numbers, and I just So grateful for the invite, and so grateful that you had me on your agenda, and I was able to be here with you all this weekend. Amen. You can all put on your hands, God. Amen. Because I don't take it for granted. I do not take it for granted, because you all could have chosen anyone to come and share with you on this weekend, but you chose me. And so I'm grateful. And my mother and my grandmother would always say, don't take things for granted. Don't do it. My mother had a gratitude book. And when she died, I got her journals. I didn't get a lot of other stuff, but I got her journals. And she just had this book. And every day, thank God for life. Thank God for my children. I thank God. I mean, it was just even for the little things and, you know, some things that we just overlook, but thank God. Thanks be unto God. Because he gives us the victory. He gives us life. He gives us strength. Amen. Amen. All right. I'm not going to keep you in here all day. I'm not going to keep you all day. But I do want you to open your Bibles. You have them. Amen. To the book of Acts. Mighty wind, and it filled all the house where they were sitting. And there appeared unto them cloven tongues like as a fire, and it sat upon each of them. And they were all filled with the Holy Ghost, and began to speak with other tongues as the Spirit gave them utterance. Father God, we thank you for this day that you have made. And Lord, I thank you for your goodness and for your mercy and your kindness. God, we thank you because you are such a mighty God. You are a God of your word. Your promises are true and they're yea and they're amen. Now, Father, I ask that you would open up our eyes that we may see. Open our ears that we may hear. God, let us be a light in a dark place. Lord, we love you and we praise you. We give you glory and honor and power because it all belongs to you. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Now, I'd like to give you a little bit of history here before we get all the way into the world. Now, Pentecost. Pentecost in its own means 50. And as I said earlier, today is officially the day of Pentecost. And how it came about, this particular one, is Jesus died and we all know the story. He died. They put him in the tomb. When they went back to the tomb, he was not there. He was not there. And Mary Magdalene had gone to the tomb. She had the Jesus. Because she was going to care for the body. And she could not find him. So she ran and told the others. And then she looked, and there was a two men standing in there. And then she was like, where is Jesus? Where is Jesus? And he said, the Jesus that you look for, he's missing. You know, and the thing is, Mary Magdalene, the disciples, they had all been together, and they had heard what Jesus had told them. He had been talking to them for years, for the 3 years of his ministry. Because when he first was called into the ministry, well, not really called, when he first started working in the ministry, he picked the disciples. And he had followers from the very beginning. So they had heard the stories. They had heard the testimony. They had heard the word. But when the time actually came, they were still startled that Jesus was not there. So a few days later, after the disciples came and they told them, they said, Jesus is not there. But Jesus came to them. He let them know that, no, nobody stole me. They didn't take my body and throw it in the sea. You know, here I am. And, you know, of course, you know the story. It was Doubting Thomas. Thomas like, I don't know. Y'all can say whatever you want. I don't believe it. He said, I'm not going to believe it until I see it. And I see the holes in his hands to make sure it's Jesus. So, you know, times passed and Jesus appeared. And Thomas was there this time so he could see him. And I kept saying, well, Lord, why did you appear to the disciples? Why did they have to see you? You know, that's just like us. He has made us promises. He has told us things. But we just sometimes, like, we trust God and we know his word and we know everything that he told us is yea and amen, but we're still a little skeptical. Amen. It's like, you know, God, you know, you said that, you know, he was going to send a husband and you said his name and you told me that he was going to be wearing a navy blue suit and you said, where is he? I have been waiting now, you know, years and years and years, ain't seen nothing even slightly similar to what you had told me that was going to happen has happened. Nothing. So I can understand why Jesus had to appear to them. And he stayed with them 40 days. He assured them and he reassured them. You know what I told you? I told you I was going to have to leave and I was going to have to go to my father. He said, but in my father's house, y'all, there's many mansions and I'm going to prepare a place for you. And where I go, there you may be also. And he said, you're going to see me again. And so they were, some of them, you know, there were some doubting people. They were probably thinking, well, we're seeing you now. No, 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 this is not it. This is not all of it. Because even if we go back to the Old Testament, back to the book of Job, he tells them, he says, your sons and your daughters are going to prophesy. The old men are going to dream dreams. The young women and the older women. He said, this is it. This is the things that were spoken of way back then. And he was just there with them to comfort them. And if many of us have lost loved ones, you know how it feels. It's difficult. It's hard sometimes. And there's some other ones that lost, and you know, you go to the service and you go eat, and that's their number. But Jesus wanted to be with them. He wanted to comfort them. He wanted them to know that this is not it. This is not all, because even in all of his teachings, he told them that he was going to send them a comforter. Now, they didn't have the comforter at that moment. They had Jesus, but that was not the comforter that he was talking about. He was like, I'm going to send you a comforter. Some of the disciples, you know, they enjoyed the time that they had with Jesus. He cooked fish for them, fish and grits. You know, they went about their activity, came back, and Jesus had fish and grits waiting for them. But it came a time when he had to go.
That's right.
He had to go. Because he was on an assignment.
Yes.
From the time the angels came and spoke to his mother and told her that she was going to give birth to the Messiah, from that time, when that egg was implanted in her, from that time, when that little embryo started to grow, Jesus was on an assignment.
Yes.
And the same with us. Because the scripture tells us in Jeremiah, before you were conceived in your mother's womb, I knew you.
Amen.
We didn't know ourselves. Some of us still a little iffy about ourselves. But before we were conceived in our mother's womb, he knew us. So Jesus had a lot to do. He had a lot to do. He had 3 years. He didn't really have a long time, but he had a lot to do. And the majority of his time was spent teaching. It is, he healed the blind, he healed the lame, he raised the dead, but all of those were teaching moments. They were all teaching moments. And we, as children of God, we've got to be teachable.
Yes.
Amen. Let's not get so high and mighty that we can't be taught. Because during Sunday morning sermon, you can't really ask questions. Because, you know, it's a little more. There are people who don't know the Lord. They're visitors. They're coming in. So you can't really ask questions. So come to Sunday school. Come to Bible study. There you can learn things. You can ask questions. Study on your own. And if you have a question when you come to Sunday school, when you come to Bible study, you can ask those questions. Let's be made teachable. And don't get so stuck. I'm not talking about anybody specific. Let's not get so stuck that we think the way we do things and the way that that's the only way. Don't get stuck that that's the only way. The method may change, but the message is still the same. And in 2016, life has changed. Technology has taken over our world. So let's not say, well, I don't know why they're doing all that. We didn't do all that when I was a kid. How long ago was that? The methodology has changed, but the message is still the same. So regardless of how we get the message out, we got to get it out. Because Jesus is coming back. He came back and he spent that time with the disciples, but I'm not talking about that time. I'm talking about the time that no man knows the day nor the hour when the Son of Man is coming back. Not even the Son of Man. Right now, he's sitting on the right hand of the Father making intercession for us. And thank God for him making intercession for me. Thank God that Jesus is sitting there. Because if you go back and read the Old Testament, Jesus didn't play. I mean, God did not play. If somebody messed up and he decided that it was time for them to go, he wiped out the whole family, the whole bloodline. Whew. But Jesus is sitting at the right hand of the Father making intercession for us today. And we got to be grateful for that. We got to be thankful. Amen?
Amen?
Amen. Give me just a second here. Let me get myself together. Jesus loves us so much. And what he did for the disciples, don't just think that he just did that for them. He loves us just as much, if not more today. He still loves us. Promise. And I got to give you a definition. What is a promise? A statement telling someone that you will definitely do something or that something will definitely happen in the future. An indication of future success or improvement. A reason to expect that something will happen in the future. Now, in our 66 books in the Bible, filled with promises. And then he goes to tell us, he assures us that every one of his promises is true. Every single one of them is true. He's a healer. He's a keeper. He's a deliverer. He's a way out of no way. He brings peace. He's a peace giver. He's a will in the middle of a will. He's the mighty rose of Sharon. He's the Prince of Peace. All of his promises are true. And there might be one or two, some more, that I haven't even come across yet. Because I don't know about you. You read your Bible and something that you read 100 times, and you read it that one day and say, wow, I didn't know that was in there. Or you get an understanding of it. Wow, I didn't know that's what that meant. In the beginning of Acts, and I want to just share this with you, Acts 1. And this is a message translation. Acts 1, verse 1. Dear Theophilus, in the first volume of this book, I wrote on everything that Jesus began to do and teach until the day he said goodbye to the apostles. The ones he had chosen through the Holy Spirit and was taken up to heaven. After his death, he presented himself alive to them in many different settings over a period of 40 days. In face-to-face meetings, he talked to them about things concerning the kingdom of God. As they met and ate meals together, He told them that they were on no account to leave Jerusalem, but they must wait for what the Father promised. The promise you heard from me, John baptized in water, and you will be baptized in the Holy Spirit, and soon. When they were together for the last time, they asked, Master, are you going to restore the kingdom to Israel now? Is this the time? He told them, you don't get to know the time. Timing is the Father's business. What you'll get is the Holy Spirit. And when the Holy Spirit comes on you, you will be able to be my witnesses in Jerusalem, all over Judea and Samaria, even to the ends of the world. These were his last words. As they watched, he was taken up and disappeared in the cloud. They stood there staring into an empty sky. Suddenly, two men appeared in white robes. They said, you Galileans, why do you just stand here looking up at an empty sky? This very Jesus who was taken up from among you to heaven will come as certainly and as mysteriously as he left. So the angels told him, Jesus is coming back. And no man, like I said earlier, no man knows the day nor the hour. And we talked about this yesterday about timing. God's timing, he operates in seasons. We are on chronological time. Minutes, seconds, minutes, hours, days, weeks, months. But God operates on chronos time. That is the perfect timing of God. And there are many places in our scripture that we will see that Jesus does not even know the timing of God. There are times that he does, but there, like in this passage, that he does not know. But we've got to be ready. Amen. We've got to be ready. The things that Jesus talked to these disciples about and the promises that he made to them, they were promises made to us. But one thing, on that day of Pentecost, it says there came a sound as a mighty rushing wind, a ruach, and that is spirit and breath. And Jesus did that. That was done at the beginning of time when he did it to Adam, when he breathed into him. And so the Holy Ghost is spirit, is life, is breath. And that was the promise that Jesus was telling them. That was the comforter. He said, I will not leave you comfortless. Even to the day, we're not comfortless. And if you are here, if you're saved, and you don't have the Holy Ghost, I tell you, today will be a real good day. It will be a real good day. You would say, yeah, I got the Holy Ghost on the day of Pentecost. It's a keeper. It's a keeper. I'm not going to tell you that you're never going to mess up, that you're never going to fall short, because you will. But you got a keeper, and you will come quickly back to the Father and repent and get in right standings with him. And when that sound of that mighty rushing wind came in and filled that place, and they started speaking in other tongues, there were people walking by, and they said, oh my, can you imagine all the 120 that had been in that room those days? 10 days Jesus had been gone. They had made their way back there. And this is just me, I don't have proof, but I know if they were children of God, they were praying, they were reading the word, they were fasting, because Jesus had told them to go and wait up there. And so they were waiting, just praying one for another, empowered by the Spirit of God, just speaking in tongues. Oh, shanda osata. Hey, namanio shaba baba sanda. Hey, namana bosita. Hey, namanio shaba baba sanda. Hey, namanio shanda. Spirit of the living God, oh, fresh on us. And as people were walking by, they heard and they said, oh, goodness, they must be drunk. But somebody said, no, they speak in my language. There were some people there from Liberia. They said they speak in Liberia. There were some Ugandans in the room. They said they speak in our native tongue. There were some people from Brazil in the room. They said they speak in Portuguese. They said, who are these people? And these were the ones, the 12 disciples. Well, at that time, they were just 11. And the women, Mary, the mother of Jesus, was in there. And the other, Mary Magdalene, Salome, all of these women that had been following Jesus. And all of a sudden, when they all started speaking in the prayer language in an unknown tongue, all of a sudden, there came in that sound. The Holy Ghost came in, and it filled the room, and they were filled with the Holy Ghost and with fire. The Bible says it was fire. It said the coals and the pins, that fire on each of them.
Yes.
It's time for us. It's time for us to get some fire. We've been lukewarm too long in the body of Christ. It's time for us to stir up the gift and get some fire. We need some fire back on the altar. Then we can speak to those hard-headed children of ours, and they'll come to church. Then we can speak to those people that don't believe, and they'll believe, they'll be transformed. Because we got an assignment. We talked about our purpose yesterday. We all have an assignment. We all need to go and tell men and women and boys and girls that Jesus Christ is Lord, and he died for us, and he rose from the dead, and he's coming back again, and except a man be born again, he shall not enter in. I don't know about you, but I don't want my co-workers and family members and my neighbors and people that I don't know to die and go to hell. I'm at church all the time, and all these people I know die and go to hell. What kind of witness is that? Because everybody don't know about Jesus. But we have an assignment. If they don't know, we have a responsibility to let them know, to tell them about Jesus. Well, Pastor, you know, I can't even talk about Jesus on my job. I don't know about your job, but at my job, they talk about almost everything. But you don't want to talk about Jesus. And I thank God I had one boss. They let her go. And it was one year, it was Christmas time. And so she says, I'm not into this happy holiday garbage. She says, Merry Christmas! Merry Christmas! She wanted to do it, and I said, and her name was Marianne. If Marianne can stand up and say Merry Christmas, what about the rest of the Christians? We need to stand up and tell people the real reason for the season. We need to tell them the reason for the season. I know it's not Christmas, but we need to tell them the reason that we celebrate the season. And then we look at our scriptures. There wasn't a time that, you know, Christmas was not one of the feasts. They weren't really celebrating that because the king was trying to kill all the babies. They were trying to kill them. If they had found Jesus, they would have killed him. So they weren't really celebrating his birth. You know, the kings, the people, the prophets, the men and women of God who knew, you know, they came, but they didn't make no grand entrance. They came, the three wise men came and brought him a gift because they reverenced who he was, but there was no big celebration because they would have killed him. Okay, that's not part of my message today. Amen. You got to remain teachable. Amen.
Amen.
Got to remain teachable.
Amen.
But what is this promise? What is it? It's the Holy Ghost.
Amen.
The promise, the comforter that will comfort you in the midnight hour when you have laid in your bed and you have prayed all night. You went to bed, you tried to go to sleep, but you couldn't go to sleep. You tossed and you turned and you tossed and you turned and you cried and you tossed and you turned. And I know when I have those times out, I don't want to stay there a long time. I said, okay, Lord, what you want to talk to me about? Let me just get on up. Let me get up and get into the presence of the Lord and see what he has to say to me. Because when I can't sleep and I'm tossing and turning, obviously what the Lord wants to share is more important than me getting this exercise. And on those nights that I've gone and I've gotten up and I've shared it, even if I got up at 2 or 3 o'clock in the morning, seems like I spent forever with the Lord. I go back to sleep for a little while and wake up refreshed. He won't wake you up if you be tired. If you're too tired to do what you got to do, I wake up refreshed.
Amen.
But that was the promise that he made to them. I'm going to send you a comforter. And so when that Holy Spirit came in there, Peter, remember Peter, cussing Peter, Peter be ready to fight, they got a switchblade and cut off people's ears, that Peter. Well, if you go on and read more down into Acts 2, Peter gave his first sermon. Peter was transformed instantly, right there on the spot. Peter, preaching Peter, Apostle Peter now, the preacher. And they came to him, they said, let me tell you something, Peter. You're going to cut that preaching out. Now, I know we celebrate the Feast of Pentecost, but you're going to cut that preaching out. Peter told him, he said, now, you know, because Peter was bold, and I'm sure Peter remembered in his mind the time that Jesus told Peter, you're going to deny me. No, not Jesus, no, no, you my boy, Peter, you're going to deny me. Jesus, I got you. Peter, you're going to deny me.
All right.
And when it happened, have you ever been on that place? When it happened,
yes.
You just felt like, oh, my God. Oh, Lord, you know I did not mean for this to happen. My intention was to be there for you. I had no intention of denying you. I know you said it, but I really was trying not to let it happen. And so I'm sure that when Peter was preaching that message, and even though the officials came and told him, you better cut that preaching out. Peter said, I guess he said, I already disappointed you one time, Father. You don't have to worry, I got you this time. He said, I rather obey God than man. And we better get to that place where we obey God rather than man. We living in this man-made illusion that we gotta obey man. I was reading something this morning. I know I tell y'all I'm always reading or listening to something. And it was talking about some pastors, and I'm not gonna call anybody's name, but he had an illegitimate child, and he apologized, and then he was saying, well, you know, God ain't through with me yet. Well, God's not through with any of us yet, but I find that a cop-out. That's a man-made excuse. God ain't through with me yet. So you just keep on doing what you're doing. You just keep on lying. You just keep on stealing. You just keep on mistreating people. Oh, God ain't through me. Ain't nobody perfect. The word says, be ye perfect as I am perfect. So I said, if you gonna come with that line, don't come to me. Ain't nobody perfect but God. He told us to be perfect. Your perfect might not look like my perfect. My perfect might not look like your perfect. But we need to try to be as perfect as we can be. I love people. I love spending time with people. I love talking about God. But I don't like those wimpy excuses. I don't like those. You know, we mess up. Perfect daddy messes up. I mess up. He didn't say go around making, because to me it's an excuse. Ain't nobody perfect. That's an excuse. What he did tell us to do is repent quickly. Me too? Then I wonder, why has this promise not come? But even when the disciples and the 120, when they were in the upper room, they had to wait on the promise. They had to wait on it. You see, because waiting is a process. And a lot of us don't like that process. Because the process is not always easy, and the process does not feel good. The process don't look good. The process sometimes is just not good. I don't want to fast. I remember telling the church we needed to go on a fast. I said, oh my, so many people, Pastor. I got to eat with my medicine. You ain't got to eat a whole pizza. I got to take my medicine 3 times a day. You can have a half a piece of toast and a little bit of juice. You'll be just fine. Somebody went to the doctor and brought a copy of the fast to the doctor. The doctor said, I think that's a good idea. It's not punishment. We call a fast because if we all go just need to let them know, you know what? I'm going away for a week. And you are. You're going to go spend time with Jesus.
Yes.
I'm not going to be able to talk to you this week. Because you know, there's some people who call you about everything. And ain't none of it about Jesus. And none of it's positive.
Drink a half a gallon of milk. I was hungry.
extra weight, say, you know what? We're going to take the kids over to grandma's house, and we're going to walk by the lake. Hold her by the hand, bring her a flower, get her a nice bottle of water, cool water, juice, and walk with her. You know, because there's a way we can do things and still get the thing accomplished rather than just being mean. Let's not be mean. I was at the church, and the ladies came. They were having a musical. And so the lady said, it's the mean church. I said, excuse me? Because the church that I pastored, it was my aunt was the pastor there. And my aunt relocated to North Carolina. She has since gone home to be with the Lord. But the ladies came and they said, this is the mean church. I said, this is not the mean church. I said, I'm not mean. They said, no, 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 not you. Them other people that was here was mean. Why would we as Christians want the unsaved to be saying that about us? Mean? Now, I don't know, if I don't agree with something that you say, I have the right to let you know where I stand on it, but I don't need to be mean. I don't need to be ugly. So that's, again, why we gotta wait. We gotta learn how to be kind. We gotta learn how to be sweet. We gotta learn how to be important without being important. So if that's what you say, we gotta learn how to be important without being important. Because some of us, you know who I am? You know my name? And I remember there was this woman. I knew she was a pastor, so I just called her, hey, pastor. Okay. Time went off. Somebody said, yeah, she didn't like that you didn't call her apostle. I said, I know she wasn't an apostle. I didn't know. We can't get caught up when it's being important. We are all children of the Most High King. We can't just get important because when you're talking to people in the world, apostle, prophet, evangelist, pastor, they may know, but some of the other ones, they're all the same to them. They're all the same. Let's don't get caught up with being important. Let's wait. Go through the process. Go through the process with patience. Because then, when the promise does come, it will fully come. It will fully come. It will fully come when the Holy Ghost comes on you, when it ascends on you like a dove out of heaven. Then you'll be able to deal with it. You'll be able to deal with if someone slaps you and you can turn the other cheek, because a lot of us ain't ready for that today. When it fully comes, you'll know when it has fully come to you, because the things that you used to do, you don't do no more. The place that you used to go, you don't go no more. I used to hear the old folks testify like that. You know, I thank God for saving me. I'm saved and I'm sanctified. Holy Ghost filled and fire baptized. From the places I used to go, I don't go no more. The things I used to say, I don't say no more. The things I used to do, I don't do no more. And we all got that thing. We all got that thorn in our flesh. But there's an answer for this, an act for that too. There's an answer for that. My grace is sufficient. My grace is sufficient. There's an act for that. My grace is sufficient. There's nothing haphazard about God. Pentecost teaches that the Holy Spirit was not poured out as a result of the fasting and the praying and being there. That wasn't the result. It was poured out because God had already made a plan for it. But we had to go through the process because they were not ready. They had to go through the process. We have to go through the process. You know, old folks used to say, sanctify, sanctification. They had to go through the process. You know, we don't even have sanctification in a lot of churches anymore. You get saved this morning, you get the Holy Ghost tonight, you a pastor tomorrow, you an apostle next week. We don't go through
us. Because in our own, with our own eyes, we need to look at ourselves. We know what ain't right about us. You don't need me to tell you what's not right about you. You already know. You already know. I already know. I already know what that thorn in my flesh is.
Coming back. Everything that he had told us, every promise, it is true. I know some people don't want to, oh, I believe all that. That's true. You can believe it or not believe it. It doesn't really matter. He's coming back. Jesus and his last words to the disciples. Told them, I'm going now. I'm going. But I'm not going to leave you by yourself. And we're blessed, even more so than the disciples in that moment, because the Comforter already exists. It's already here. We have to receive it.
Amen.
We have to receive it. There is nothing that you have in your life that is more important than your relationship with the Father and the Son.
Amen.
Nothing. Nothing. And if you would receive the Comforter, a lot of things that you're dealing with, you won't have to deal with them. Because you'll have somebody there talking in your ear, but they won't be talking negativity. They'll remind you of the word. You're more than a Comforter. You're more than a Comforter. You know you can do this. You can do all things through Christ Jesus who strengthened you. You know I'm never going to leave you. I'm never going to forsake you. You know I'm always with you.
Amen.
You can do this. I'm with you. You can do this. You can call on me anytime. I'm with you. You can do this. You know the times when you just wanted to do something. You had your fist balled up. You were just ready to just do it. But you heard the Holy Spirit say, don't do that. Don't do that. Don't say that. That's when we have the Comforter, the promise. And once we get that Comforter, once we get that promise, you'll be surprised how many things you didn't even know you could do that you can do. Coming to church won't become a chore. Praying won't become an obstacle for you all the time. You'll be able to do it. Because the promise lives in you.
Yes.
You will become the promise. Oh, she's getting deep on me now. You will become the promise. Because you, me, us, we're the only Jesus that some people know.
Amen.
Wait a minute. I'm going to have to make sure it's part of me. The Jesus that lives in us is the only Jesus that some people know. Because some people don't go to church. They might be of another religion. They might be Muslim. They might be Buddhist. They might even be a witch.
Amen.
A witch? Yeah. Yeah. What do they call them? Waka? Wicca? Yeah. I know you're just fooling at my job. I tell you, I'm asking more of my job than anywhere else. And, I remember when I first got the job, we were going through orientation, and she had made this cake. So everybody was saying, oh, come on, Cherry, you can have some. It's good. I said, no, I'm good. I don't want none. And what really made me not want any is because a few days before, she had said, somebody had got stung by a bee, and her friend, who was a witch, touched it, and the bee sting went away. I said, oh, Lord, you ain't getting ready to feed me no cake. Because I was watching all these other folks over here that ate the cake. They was mesmerized about this cake. I said, nah, I'm going home with this cake. I stopped at the store on the way over this cake. I don't want any cake. But, you know, as time went on, I am who I am. whether I'm here or there or wherever. I am who I am. So I said, Lord, I said, she seemed like a nice enough woman. I said, she got to be saved. The Lord said, buy her a Bible and have her name engraved on it. So before I gave her the Bible, she was telling me she had met some man, and the man was telling her about Jesus, and she asked him a question. I said, you know, I got something for you. So if we would just listen to the voice of the Lord, amen, if we would just listen to what he's saying and go for doing, we'll make a difference. Now, I don't know, you know, she does. She had surgery not too long ago. She said, well, pray for me. Now, I'm not sure if she knows the whole process yet, but she has the word.
Amen.
And so that's what he told me to do. So I still, I eat lunch with her every now and then. I don't eat no cake. But I do eat lunch with her, you know, on Thursdays. You know, and I do talk about the word. And so we have to just be who we are. I'm believing God that one day she's going to tell me, or she's going to ask me, Jerry, how does the same thing work? How does it work? Or God will present an opportunity where I'll just be able to tell her how it works.
Right.
Timing is important.
Right.
It's important. Day of Pentecost, the day of power, the day of spirit, the day of breath was fully come.
Yes.
They were all on one accord. They were all filled. They were all speaking in tongues. And you know, there are some places where people say, if you that have not never spoken in tongues, you ain't got it. I don't see that in the scripture. It does say there that the tongues were evidence. It doesn't even specifically say that, but they spoke in tongues, so that was evidence. So let's not go around judging everybody again.
Yeah.
Let's not be too so important that we important, okay?
Yes, sir.
Let's not go around judging people.
Amen.
Be careful. Amen. Be careful.
Amen.
One more thing, and I'm getting ready to wrap it up. I gotta say this. I know we're living in a day where homosexuality has become the new norm. Talking about transgender bathrooms, on and on and on and on and on. Homosexuals got to be saved too.
Amen. That's right.
They got to be saved too. Jesus come back for them. He coming back. Every knee shall bow. Every tongue's gonna confess. Homosexual tongues, lesbian tongues, white tongues, black tongues, Donald Trump tongues. Bless you, mother. Every one of them. Everyone. So we have a purpose. We learned that yesterday. We have an assignment. Go preach the word. Teach the word to the uttermost parts of the earth. We got to do that. That everybody. I don't care if you just got saved last night, if you just got saved in Sunday school. Everybody has that responsibility. Tell somebody about Jesus. About Jesus. The promise of God is yea, nay, nay, y'all.
Amen.
I can't, you know, just keep reiterating that enough. God's promises are true.
Yes.
And even if it doesn't look like it, even if it doesn't feel like it, you're thinking, I can go with the natural, so it surely doesn't look like it's going to happen. God trusts us enough with the comfort. He trusted us enough with the comfort, send the comfort. But can he trust you to be the comfort? Can he trust you to be a comfort?
Amen.
Can he trust you to be a comfort? Because sometimes we're hard on people. Stop acting crazy. Maybe they're not acting. Maybe they need prayer. You know, we can think of all the promises throughout the scripture. Mary, the angel came, told her, promised her, you're going to birth the Messiah. The promises he promised to Abraham and Sarah. Abraham, you're going to be the father of many nations. Well, down in Abraham's time, there are only two identified continents, Africa and Asia. That is Hispanic. You know, the people, they give us an estimate of how many people are on the earth, but I can't say that's accurate. Because if they knew all of the people on the earth, they'd be able to get the message to all of the people, and Jesus would be coming and come back. So I can't really say that they know how many people even exist on earth. The promises he made Abraham.
Yes.
And we're sons and daughters. The promises that he made, we're entitled to them. We're entitled to the promises. I don't know if that's if I'm ever going to get my promise. Will you go the distance?
Yes.
Will you go the distance? Will you go the distance when your body's sick and racked with pain? Will you go the distance when your children act in a fool? Will you go the distance when your spouse act like they don't love you no more? They might not be acting. Will you go the distance when your spouse don't love you no more? Will you go the distance if you get laid off your job? Your house foreclosed on? Your car repossessed? Or will you want to say, God, why did you do this today? Even if what he promised you, the total opposite happens, know that it was for your good.
Come on. Amen.
Know that it was for your good.
Yes.
All things work together for good to those who love God and are called according to his promise.
Yes.
There's one scripture that's one of my favorites. It was good that I was afflicted. It was good that I was afflicted. It was good that I got away from, well, I got away from the abusive relationship. Because now there can be a space in my life for the one that God's want me to have. It was good that I was physically ill in my body because now I can be compassionate towards other people who are sick and minister on a whole nother level. It was good that I was afflicted that my son was locked up in jail because when me and my other son went to the courthouse to pray, not only was I praying for my son, but I could pray for other people's sons and daughters. It was good that I was afflicted. He said, it was good that I was afflicted, that I may know you in the fullness of your power. Pentecost. Ruach. When the day of Pentecost was fully come, we were all in one place on one accord. Amen. God bless you. Put your hands together. Come on, now. Hallelujah! Hallelujah! The altar is open. If there's someone here today, you can say, you know, Pastor, I've been saved for 30 years, 40 years, but I don't know if I have the Holy Ghost. If you don't know, you don't have it. But the altar is open today. Amen. I want you to grab hands with your neighbors. If you won't come to the altar, come on. But for those who are going to be there, I want you to just grab hands with your neighbors all across the aisle. Grab hands. Grab hands. The reason I'm asking you to grab hands, because I want us to be on one accord. I want us to be on one accord. Because there's none of us in here that's better than anybody else. If it wasn't for the grace of God, And I want you all to stop praying in your prayer language.
You are my joy.
Come on, clap your hands and praise. Hallelujah. Come on, bless the name of the Lord this place. Hallelujah. We worship the Most High and Mighty God. Come on, lift your voice and give God a shout of praise and praise. Hallelujah. We give God honor and praise. Amen. The altar is open. If you need any prayer for any reason, you can come at this time. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. We thank God for Pastor Brown. Amen. Amen. Hallelujah. For we know that we have purpose. Amen. God has a plan and a purpose for our lives. And he will see it to completion. The work that he has started within you, he shall see it to completion. Amen. Hallelujah.
Thank you. is a testimony. All my love, my life is a
I know it was the blood. I know it was the blood.
God bless the preacher. God bless the preacher. God bless the preacher. Amen. We thank God for the preacher. Amen. Wasn't that such an awesome word, saints? Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. We thank God for the message and the messenger. Come on back tonight at 6 o'clock for this evening service. Yes, it's true. There are some refreshments downstairs, so please help yourself. It all must go for those in the trash. Amen.
I know that I was far swept, but I know from someone that, like, you know, God has called. Sometimes you go and you share and you don't know who you affected. So I feel like I have to tell you that me and my wife have been going through the process of purchasing a house. And anyone that's been through that process, you know, it's a trying process, because every house you look at, you want, and then when you want it, sometimes it goes back and forth. So in the process, I've found myself just being silent, because I've gotten angry, like saying, you know, God, it's our time, it's our season. I know you want more for my babies and me, and your word, especially the part where God gave you, you know, the word to speak about, when it's bad, when you still push on, you still move on. That was what I needed to hear this week. You know, God has done so much for me, and people in this church know that. When I came here, I couldn't even get a job. I was straight out of prison in a mess. And God has restored me and put me in a place where finances are not a problem. And, you know, I'm a better father than I've ever been. I continue to grow and learn. So who am I, you know, to be upset at the sanctification process? Because that's what it is. He wants me to wait, and he wants me to know that when I get this, that it was him, and that to be appreciative of it, not to move in and be boastful and with my house. No, it's God's house. God gave it to my family, and it's a sanctuary for me to be the high priest and to overlook the will he has with the lives he's given me. So I got that perspective, and I just wanted you to know, you know, I'm sure other people, because you're a mighty woman of God, but thank you for being obedient, coming here to share God's word with us.
We're giving the scripture readings over to Pastor Brown. We're going to say a special word of prayer over her. Father God, we thank you for the mighty woman of God that you have sent to this house, oh God. So God, we thank you for the word that has fallen on good ground, oh God, that we may be able to pick it up and run further with it, oh God. But we've been reestablished that we have a purpose. And even on this day of Pentecost, oh God, when you said your disciples and those that were with them up into the upper room, oh God, they spent many days praying and seeking your face, oh God, that we may be able to do that the same way what you did before, you can do it again, oh God. So we thank you for the word that has come forth this morning as she goes off and travels to her next destination, oh God. Give her safe trial, grace, and mercy, oh God. And oh God, please forgive me for not knowing my other sister's name, oh God, but bless her and keep on encouraging her, oh God. Use her in a mighty way, oh God. I know that you have something special planned, that you have planted in her life, oh God, that it may be able to grow and it shall prosper, oh God. So we thank God for both anointed ladies being at the house, oh God. In Jesus' mighty name we pray. Amen. Amen. Praise God. Any birthdays? No? Any wedding anniversaries?
My birthday's next Friday.
Yeah. Amen. So your birthday, happy birthday. Happy birthday. So again, come back on tonight at 6 o'clock for our hour of power. And be reminded of all the announcements that were made earlier this morning. If you want to participate in the night of the Lord, please see my mom, Dorinda Jones, after service. And those that want to be part of the group song that we're working on for the night of the Lord, please grab and practice right after the service. Amen. So reach out and touch somebody's hand. Make this world a better place. Because you definitely can. Amen. Reach out and touch.